Praise God. Verse 10, are we there? And Abimelech said, "What is this you have done to us? One of our people might soon have laid with your wife, and you would have brought guilt on us." Verse 11. So Abimelech charged all these people, saying, "He who touches this man or his wife shall surely be put to death." Now, watch, there's the same promise, because there is a mark. Now, if you are aware of the mark of God upon your life, number one, you will not be afraid. Number two, you will have no need to lie. People only lie because they think they cannot come out of a situation. Are we together? People only steal what they think they can make. People only what? So because somebody felt they cannot pay their rent, so they have to steal, they have to do fraud, they have to do, because they believe that they cannot go without, I mean, there's no way they are going to survive. Every time your faith is shutting, you need to run to God for reassurance. Lord, reassure me. Lord, kindle my faith. My faith is, I know that you will rescue me. I know that your word say. He said, now, he said, once I was young, now I am old. I have never seen the righteous forsaken, neither is sick begging for bread. You cannot go hungry. And there is nothing, let me say this to you, there is no weapon that is formed against you that shall prosper. But yet, when certain things rise against us, certain people, they become fearful. And because they become fearful, they begin to take steps that are contrary to God. They begin to exhibit lie. There are many ways to get things done, but there is only one way that is right, and that is the right way. There are many ways to get things done, but there is only one way that is right, and that is the right way. I'll say that again. There are many ways to get things done, but there is only one way that is right, and that is the right way. The grace to walk in the right path, the Lord will grant unto every one of us in the name of Jesus. Let me stop that reading for a while and let's just look at it. He said, this is the only chapter that the figure as a chief character is not as prominent and aggressive as his father. That is Isaac. I describe Isaac, whose name was Laughter, to us a little bit. He was a very great man also, but he has a different character, different from his father. The aggressive, the going for it, leader, or like his grandson, which is the son of Isaac himself, Jacob. But Isaac was rather an introvert. Isaac was calm. Isaac was patient. Isaac was unassuming. He was submissive. In his contact with people, he treated people with decorum. He was not abrasive. He's not forward. He was not a cheat. He considered others. He was soft. He was gentle. While his father and son, who are like peak above him, he rather chose to live a very quiet and faithful life. He faced his own business. He tried not to fight other people for anything. There was no account of him trying to fight anybody or conquering. What have you? He just faced his own business. But one thing that we saw that shaped his life for the rest of his life was the encounter at Mount Moriah. At Mount Moriah, the day his father took him, and all the way, when you take a child of about 16, 17, all the way to Mount Moriah, and the boy is asking, "Father, where is the ram?" We believe that this was one of the major events that determined the personality of Isaac. If you want, for the want of experience, that also shaped his life, one of the very things that shaped his life, again, was the fact that he grew up in a house where he had a brother. And if you are a child, one thing you want to see around you is another child. But his brother was 13 years older than him. His brother would care for him, but he had to. There is mutiny, or how do you call it? There is negativity in the house. When he goes to play with his brother, his mother would draw his leg back and say, I don't want to see you. When they tried to mix together, this boy had lots of questions growing up that he couldn't answer. There are many mysteries about his family that is still unraveling today that Isaac did not understand. Isaac did not understand, why is it that we cannot cross to that side of our property? Why is it that we cannot? Why is it that daddy also owned that other person? Why is it that that child also belongs to my father? Why is it that it's being said that I am the heir, but this is also his son? And then he broke down at one point when his brother had to be separated from him. You know, when you had only two of you in the house and two of you can only play football together, and all of a sudden, the only brother that he had been chased away from the house in a very disturbing situation. Now watch this. Do you think the atmosphere over that house would have been conducive? Do you think it would have been the atmosphere over that house grew from the day he was born? Do you think the atmosphere over that kind of polygamy marriage, do you think it was conducive for him to grow? Parent, we create with our own life, with the things we have created before the children arrive, with the kind of communication that is, and the tone of communication, the style of communication between ourselves in the house, in the family, we set the tone for the temperament and the personality of our children. Is this making sense to us? We set a tone. The father favors this, the mother favors that. And before you realize it, you begin to create polarity already in the mind of children. Mommy said this, but daddy will say that. And by the time you begin to have divisiveness or the division in the house, invariably you begin to plant it in the mind of the children, and their personality began to perform. But in an environment where both parents are one, in an environment where both parents, like I said to us, I shared with us a few weeks ago when I was considering also the life of Isaac and the life of Rebecca, his wife. We saw Rebecca being an extrovert. You saw it from the day she was found in the river. She ran towards the man. She's an extrovert to the extreme. But you saw the husband. The Bible said he was a quiet man there. He sat down there just waiting at the... He was a very, very quiet man. And when they were going to get, when they were going to raise children, they raised the opposite. So the introvert child clings towards the mother. And the extrovert child clings towards the father. Because you always attract what you lack. You always what? Your opposite. You always attract what you lack. Many of us know that we cannot marry us. I know my temperament. As a matter of fact, I was close to somebody similar to my temperament. And it did not take me long for me to just know that we could never. There was no way two of us could be in the same boat. It could not have worked. It would be a marriage full of headache. It would be fight, 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 and fight. Just as friends, me and this person will fight. And I almost swerve off the road. We will argue. Hey, my God, can you be thinking like that? This cannot end. There is no way this can ever turn into. But by the time you see somebody, you know you are not a go-getter. You know you are not what have you. And then you see somebody and you admire what you lack. But here is the problem. If I can revisit that again. Instead of developing their marriage, a mother becoming romantic with the father, and the father become romantic with the mother. Instead, they begin to replace the affection for each other in the children. Parents, we need to grow up and be careful. Because if you give children what belongs to mother, or you give what belongs to father to the children, there is something huge that is lacking. And invariably, we are creating a gap for a fault. Don't worry. the proper structure of a family is that love should be cascaded. Are we together? It should be what? It should be something that is seen. It should be something that is witnessed. It should be something that is felt. It should be something that is, it is alive, that they should see and know from us. Praise God. In the two lessons of the extreme, or as I consider it today, the two types of life that Abraham lived, of Isaac. I said, number one, Isaac as a sinner. And how do we say this? Number one, we said, because of his guilt, or the guilty of lying. He was guilty of lying. And we saw that through verses 1 and 11 already. But now, through this process of this first aspect of his life, there was one thing that we also learned, is that God's promise for Abraham was confirmed. God's promise for what? For Abraham was confirmed. There was famine in the land. There was famine in Palestine. There was famine in Abraham's time. We saw it in Genesis chapter 12, from verse 1, but we saw particularly from verse 10. Let's quickly go there. Genesis 12:10. Hallelujah. He said, now there was what? Let's all read together. And in the land, and Abraham went down to where? And he went down to what? There for a famine, and was severe in the land. Not only would it happen to Abraham, it is now happening to Isaac. And in Genesis chapter 46, it also happened to Jacob. Genesis 41, verse 56. Praise Jesus. Let's all read together. He said, and there was famine over the face of the earth. And Joseph, that's in the time of Joseph, and opened the store and sold to the Egyptians. At the time of Jacob also, there was famine. So everyone at any time will witness some form of famine. There is always famine. So it's not now that we are hearing there is recession. Some people are writing that there is famine. Hey, the economy of Nigeria is this. There has always been a time where there is famine in every place. The famine will never last for life. It's always for a period. It has come to go. But what is our response? It. And what is our way of escape? I like what somebody says, that when God bless you with more money, it's not the time to increase your spending. It's a time to increase your giving. It's a time what? Because that what God has given to you is your seed, is your preservation, like in the time of Joseph. We also saw that there was famine in the land at the time of Ruth. In the book of Ruth, chapter 1, verse 1. There was also famine in the land at the time. There was famine in the land at the time of Ruth. Let's all read it together. Now it came to pass in the day when the judge ruled, and there was famine in the land. At the time of David also. 2 Samuel chapter 21. Let's also go there. 2 Samuel 21, verse 1. Hallelujah. Now there was famine in the land in the days of David. For how many years? 3 years. Let me say, the famine of every land is always specific for a period. The recession hit this nation. And there was a time in 2008. Is it 2008? The famine that was in this land, I don't know about you, but it was like it could smell, you could feel it in the atmosphere. How many of us were here 2009. It's like there was a darkness, thick darkness. Major stores were just closing. You'll be walking in the city center and you just be surprised. We were going, at one point, we were going into some stores to go and pick things for free. Like maybe the final day. You just go there, you pack things, you go home. I said, what is this? And it was all over Europe. It was spreading into America. And the famine, but it went. Everything, those stores got bought by another store. Things have been sold again. Everything is bubbling again. And they scare you again. They say, ah, there is a sign of recession. He said, tell them, let it come. It will come and go. There was something that struck me at that time. I had a friend. When the recession was going on, and somebody was having a conversation with us, and that friend of mine said, he said, look, I have learned not to be afraid because they are giving us the report of the Bank of England. I do not back with the Bank of England. I back with HSBC. Are you with me? And that just changed my mentality. That everybody is scared because the Bank of England is reporting. He said, I do not bank with the Bank of England. I bank with the bank, with HSBC. And I just inverted that. I do not bank with the bank of this world. I do not bank with the Bank of England. I bank with my Heavenly Father. I bank with God. So what your focus is, or where your focus is, determines where your blessing is from. Where your focus is, if you consider the soil to plant as your source, if the soil is barren, you remain barren. But if you look up to the one who created the soil, and you sow into him, and you look unto him, he makes whatever you sow, wherever he wants you to sow it, to begin to blossom, to begin to multiply. So we looked at what the Lord said unto him. The Lord appeared unto him. This is the first time that we could see the account of the Lord appearing to Isaac. The second and the last one is recorded in Genesis chapter 26, verse 24. We're not there yet. He's definitely told not to go down to Egypt. God and Esau were about 15 years, Jacob and Esau were about 15 years of age at this time. You could see that in Genesis chapter 25, verse 7. They were young at the time. Let's read it. Genesis 25, verse 7. He said, this is the sum of the years of Abraham's wife, which he lived 175 years. By that estimation, plus the time that Isaac was living and the time that the children was given, we came up with the fact that these children were 15 years old at this time of the famine. Praise God. Isaac was born unto Abraham when he was 100 years old, and Sarai was 90 years old. He was 37 years when his mother died, 40 when he married. He married at 40. We already read that in chapter 25, verse 20. Let's read verse 20. Isaac was 40 years old when he took Rebekah. Hallelujah. 40 when he married. 75 when Abraham died. So based on all of these calculations together, we came up with his eight children's age. But read that in Genesis 25, verse 7. 75 when we already read that. So let's move on to, he sojourned in the land. The Lord said to him in verse 3, he said, the Lord will be with you. The blessing promised to Abraham are here definitely to be renewed with him. The seed was to be numbered as the sand of the seashore, like God said to Abraham in Genesis 22, verse 17. So Isaac's seed shall number as the stars of heaven, which was the blessing of Abraham. The seed reaches the climax in the Christ. His seed went as far as into Galatians chapter 3, verse 16. Let's all read it together. Galatians chapter 6, 3, verse 16. Galatians 3, verse 16. Can we all read it together? Now to Abraham and his seed, where the promise made, he does not say, and to seed as of many, but as of one, and to your seed, who is Christ. So by the promise of Abraham, there was the appearance of Christ. That is how Jesus became the great, 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 great grandson of Abraham. So God's covenant once struck with you. When I said God struck a covenant of health with me and of strength with me. When God signed a covenant, I said, spoke to me in 1996 also. And he said to me, I'm your shield and you're exceeding, 1995 rather, and you're exceeding great reward. And God asked me a question, what's the reward of labor? And I answered in that conversation. Well, God was saying there, the covenant he has with me is passing it on to my generation, to my children. Like I spoke on Sunday in the first service about encounter. Once you struck an encounter with God, it does not just last you, it lasts you, even with your children. Praise God. Children, every covenant of God enacted is generational and is also eternal. God does not, you do not recover from God's covenant. When God struck a covenant with David, up to today, there is a man from his lineage that must rule. Are you all with me? So when God, if you can secure an encounter with God, it's like you have struck a gold mine that is yours for life. And one encounter with God is sufficient. More encounter is even better. But imagine now having regular encounters with God. Regular encounters with God. Now, let me say this to you. No matter how big your expectations are, and no matter how powerful your needs are, if you can tie it to a divine encounter with God, the problem is solved. If it can lead you to getting an encounter, I hope I have everybody with me. If you can catch the attention of God like Jacob did, if you can catch the intention of God and you can have a recordable encounter, a tangible encounter, that problem is solved. That problem is what? So if Pharaoh is free, instead of running down to Egypt, going here and there to look for the answer, a lot of the time what you need to do is to get down on your knees, is to open the word of God, is begin to ask God, is begin to search from the Lord. Lord, lead me to my place of encounter. Lord, show me what must I do. Show me what must I do. Lord, visit me. So we saw Abraham obey the voice of the Lord as God was saying himself in that verse 5. He obeyed the commandment of the Lord. Now, I want us to read from verse 11. We're still looking. And Isaac walked in the footsteps of his father. He said, is my sister, the son, under similar circumstances as his father, followed his dad in the same old sin, responding as a coward, fear and lying. Hallelujah. Now let's quickly go to Isaac, the peacemaker. Isaac, the peacemaker. Now, I want us to read from verse 12 to 34 very quickly of that same chapter. And let's see. We have looked at Isaac's life that was surrounded as Isaac as a liar and Isaac as fearful. But the fact that he lied does not really make him a liar. But also because he lied, it remained in his account that he lied. Now, please watch this. The fact that you lie does not mean that you are a liar. The fact that you fail does not mean you are a failure. It's just that whatever you have done sometimes become recordable, and we are only looking at it today, not because we want to name Isaac a liar, but we are looking at learning from that life pattern. Is somebody with me? So, but let's look at him as a peacemaker. Verse 12, let's read from verse 12. And Isaac sowed in that land and reaped in the same year. How many fold? Can we all read it together? Can we see the screen? Is there a way we can read it more? We can't read it properly from the screen media. And Isaac sold in the land and reaped in the same year 100-fold, and the Lord blessed him. Whatever you can do, media, we can't see the words well. Please follow us. Hallelujah. Are they hearing me? Is anybody in the media? Hallelujah. Verse 13. And the man, now watch and read this together with me carefully. Everybody. The man began to prosper and continued prospering until he became very prosperous. I want you to say it again. The man began to prosper. He continued prospering until he became very prosperous. I want you to say it again. The man began to prosper and continuing prospering until he became very prosperous. That is my definition of success. I always define success as making progress in succession. It meant that before Isaac died, before Abraham died, Isaac was not prospering. Because if he was prospering, the Bible would not have given us a chronology of he began to prosper. He inherited wealth, but he had no prosperity. He inherited his father's land, but he had no prosperity. So the farming was sufficient. Look, there is no matter the savings that is passed on to you, and there is no amount of money you earn from investment or salary, you can finish it at any time, depending on the volume of the recession. Are you with me? Depending on the circumstances and what happens in terms of the famine. People have sold what their father have worked for 50 years, and they all finish the money in 1 month. Are you with me? My father worked as a civil servant for several years. 20-something years, I can't remember. Several years. But guess what? By the time we collect the gratuity, it was a few million naira, or what have you. Before we know it, it took less than 6 months. Everybody's share is, you have finished. Thank God we built a house from it. But before you know, any inheritance, no matter the size of it, can finish. It can finish. But when God's hand is on you, and when you have a relationship with God, when you have peace with God, when you have covenant with God, you can exhaust inheritance, but you cannot exhaust covenant. You can exhaust what? Inheritance, but you cannot exhaust covenant. There are covenants that my father struck with God that makes no matter where I live. No matter where I live, no matter where I am, no matter my place on the face of the earth, certain covenant that God has struck with my father to protect his children is working for us. I will take care of them for you. The same thing, you must find what God is covenanting with you, so that you can be able to pass beyond inheritance to your children. You can give to your children and pass them, bring them into a covenant with God. When God struck a covenant with me in 1997, and he said, and his name shall be great. What God did with me was to bring me into a covenant with him. Now, I always say this, I love my surname with passion. Especially I love the way white people call my surname. Then on top of that, I love my father with passion. So there was, unless it was God, there was no way I would have changed my surname from McIntyre. You know, when white people are calling it McIntyre, the name was very popular in Nigeria. Very popular. Hickings, I love it. But when God met with me and he said to me, I'm starting a fresh family from you, and this shall be great from generation to generation. Look at what the Lord is doing today. Great, great, great. Because it was not just meant for Sunday. He spoke to great. And from inside great, great lining began. Now, years and thousands of years today, you see the generation of the great. Because it's not just a name change, it was a covenant between me and God. Is somebody getting what I'm talking about here? Now, especially from the Yoruba land and the Jewish people, many people did not realize that most of the depth of their name came from encounter. Ogundipe, Ogunwola have you. There is something that happened with an oracle. There was a word, there was a situation, and based on the circumstances or consultation, they named and they founded based on an encounter that you are not part of. And some people are still suffering from the encounter that was tied up in one village somewhere, and they did not have an encounter with God for a change of name or a change of path. Some people are deadlocked in a covenant that they did not know how it's hurting or blessing them. You need an encounter with God to reveal your future to you. Some people need to detach themselves from what is not working. Some people need to detach themselves. There are several people that have parents who have caught covenant with the devil unknowingly. With poverty unknowingly. There are some people, no matter how they gather, it's like basket. They are just never able to account for anything at all. And when you look at it, father was like that. When you look at it, grandfather was like that. We're not just talking about generational curses. We're talking about generational covenants. These are covenants. But check it. By that encounter of Genesis chapter 12, until Jesus come, every descendant of Abraham became blessed. Every descendant of what? Of Abraham became blessed. By the encounter of May 1997, all my generation until Jesus come, just inherited part of that covenant that I struck with God. May you have a genuine encounter with God. I said, may you have a genuine encounter with God. Now, please, let's read it further. Were we in verse 13 now? Is that 13? Let's read it. The man began to prosper and continued prospering until he became very prosperous. Verse 14, everybody. For he had possession of flocks. Watch this. From famine, his status changed from needing to go to Egypt to obeying the voice of God and standing where he wants to. The first thing that happened to him is that he obeyed and he planted. When he planted, everything he planted, the Bible said, he began to give forth hundredfold. You put in little effort and you see plenty results. God can take you into a season that I call God Bogo Fole. You do little thing and it just begins to blossom. You touch this and it works. Although you are not perfect, you touch that one and that one too is working. This one is attracted into your life. That one is attracted into your life. It is not just because of your brain. It is because of a covenant. It is not because of your brain. It's because of what? It's because of a covenant. The riches. I cut a covenant with God once. He said, kings shall be your nursing father. He said, and queens shall be your nursing mother. Since that time, some people fight over ownership. Oh, it's my son. I'm his mother. I'm his father. I'm his, what have you? People that strike covenant with God become preferred on the face of the earth. They are not perfect people, but they become preferred. They are not what? They are not perfect people, but become preferred people. God's covenant make you preferred. And then he went from that status of reaping hundredfold to the fact that he began to prosper. Because it's not everybody who reaps that prospers. Reaping and your business is working does not equal prosperity. But not only did he begin, he continued prospering and he became very prosperous. But now it didn't end with that. Because we saw the blessedness of his father. The Bible said at one point, There were 18, how many people? 18,000 people living that were Abraham's servant. That is how blessed Abraham was. So the famine has dried all of this. But let's see again, verse 16, what began to happen to Isaac? The Bible said, and he began to have what? Maid servant? Are we? Now, the 14, verse 14. For he had possession of flocks and possession of herds and great store of servants. So the Philistine envied him. You are not blessed until the point that your blessing gets into a place of envy. Are you with me? There's a place that a Live Bible Church will get to. There's a time a Live Bible Church will get to where other people will begin to envy you. You know, when we moved here, there was a lot of envy. How can 1 year old? And then we just, people were looking. But God will, yes, do mighty things. It will get to a point whereby, you see, when people cannot explain your blessing, they turn it into mystery. They say, if you remember, he went to Nigeria. They went on one mountain. He collected something. He came back. Everything just begin to, everything begin to change. You see that person that brought, they brought it for him. I pray in the name of Jesus that God will do things in our life, in your life, that your detractors will have to be finding ways to explain it. And they will never be able to find it. I said they will never be able to find it. Now, you don't need anything. You only need the covenant. You don't need what? You don't need anything. There is nothing that is required. Let me. I was somewhere yesterday, and today in another country, and somebody was narrating with me how a pastor, you know, I don't know how to explain it in English, Gbebod, you know, what is Hebo, you know, did. There is nothing. He said, look, here are the evidences. Yes, about 26 teeth. That is spread, what have you. So I said, so how many people are in the church? When they told me the number, and I look at how long the person has been in ministry. I said, so if for all of that, running from Eta to Sketa, beboying and what have you, if that is what they have to show for, then it's not really working. That is not the way to go. That's not where the blessing is. But when you strike the covenant with God for your life, to bless you. If you like, you can just be laughing. Have you not seen other people just prospering because they just make other people laugh? Have you not seen John Stewart? Who is just a natural person that makes people laugh? But today, probably very few Americans, even politicians, understand the American politics or constitution better than him. And by the way, my spirit just began to say to me, I don't know. You can't find him any longer. He replaced, he's now replaced with, what's his name? Trevor Noah, or his show. And something is telling me in my spirit that that guy may enter politics. But look at that. All he's good for is just like any other person from any country, basket mound or what have you. Look at George Weah. George Weah was just a footballer here. But the first African, you could see that grace of God is upon him. The first African from a nation that, how many people are in Liberia? The overall population of Liberia, I don't think Liberia is still up to 3 or 4 million people. Now, out of all of them, that is not even up to one quarter of the size of Lagos. That's the whole country. He managed to become the best footballer in the world. And that guy, do you know how long he's been going for presidency of Liberia? He failed, he will start again. He failed, he will start. And look, as far as I'm concerned, one day he will definitely become the president of that country. But God will prosper us unto the place that people will envy. Those who don't know will know that God's grace and covenant is with us in the precious name of Jesus. I said, those who don't know will know that God's blessing is upon you. that it is upon me. Now let's quickly look at, let's read it on. Now that the Philistine has stopped all up, all is well, all the well, which his father, servant, a dog in the days of Abraham, his father. What this means, well, at that time, the well constitutes business. So they've closed all the businesses that his father owned. They have taken over most of the businesses that the father owned. They've taken all the wells, and they had filled them with earth. That means they brought closure to all of the businesses Abraham had. What made Abraham prosperous? They've closed down the business. They've challenged. So Isaac had to start from ground zero. He had to start what? From ground zero. Verse 16. And Abimelech said unto Isaac, go away from us, for you are much mightier than we. This was a man that was afraid of the people. And so that he can eat, he had to lie. He was afraid of how great the people were, that he was hiding. And he lied about his wife. But from that status of cowardly, from that status of the one you may call or we may call a liar, of the one that is imperfect, let me say this, God can still enact his covenant in spite of your worst weakness. Are you with me? Because inside of your mess is a voice of God calling you out with a message. Inside of what? Inside of your mess. God is trying to walk you out. He's going to lead you on. In your most vulnerable situation, God is saying something to you that will lead you to your high place. God is saying, stop that. Don't go down there. Don't get addicted to that. Don't become that disobedient. Don't continue that. Cut that tie off. Renew this covenant. Walk in this path. And as you begin to listen for his voice, you begin to prosper. You continue to prosper. And you become very prosperous. Many people are not seeing this because they are tied up in their heart. They are arrogant in their heart. There are so many people that their head and their mindset and opinion and principle are stronger than the voice of God. So when God is leading or speaking, they can't hear because they are already patent. They already have a set way in which they want to follow life or they want to do things. And if it doesn't fall within that parameters, then it is not God. I pray that God will open up our spirit in the name of Jesus. Let's keep on reading it if we may actually finish it. Hallelujah. Then Isaac departed from there and pitched his tent. Let's see the scripture alone, please. And pitched his tent in the valley of Gera and dwell there. Verse 18. Please remove this picture. Let's read only the, thank you. And Isaac dug again the well of water, which they had dug in the day of Abraham, his father. For the Philistine had stopped them up after the death of Abraham. He called them by the names which his father had called them. In other words, he went over all the businesses his father had started. And he renamed them exactly the same name that the father had started them. He went back and built his father's house. He went back and reinstated Akintayo Square Enterprise. Whatever the father had started that died, he said, what, this is my mission. I'm going to put it in place. Hallelujah. And Isaac's servant dug in the valley and found a well of running water there. This now is different from. In the attempt to resuscitate his father's businesses and reputation, all of a sudden, he found something else. What is it? That is fresh. That is next level. Verse 20, everybody together. And the herdsmen of Gerar quarreled with Isaac's herdsmen, saying, the water is ours. So he called the name, well, Ezek, because they quarreled with him. This was the first time that the guys, like, look, I've moved away from Akintayo School Enterprise. Now I've found my own business. This is something of my own. And all of a sudden, there was opposition against his life. There was opposition against the business. There was opposition. And the Bible says that the people quarreled with him, so that business folded. Let's go on. But the henchmen of Gerar quarreled with Isaac. Then they dug another well and quarreled over that one. So he called his name Sidna. Now watch this. That he was failing, but he was failing forward. The fact that one business failed in your hand is not the end of your life. It didn't stop there. Now watch where he started from. He started from going back. He did not just start from his own business. He started from reinstating his father's business. To the point that he's now starting businesses, the business one gone, and now it now is also gone. And then he moved from there and dug another well. And they did not quarrel over it. If you don't give up, you will soon reach your Rehoboth. So he called its name Rehoboth because he said, for now the Lord has made room for us. And we shall be fruitful in the land. If you keep pursuing, if you keep going, you will get to a place of plenty. You will get to a place of abundance. This is what God is doing with me personally, using this year to transport me and my family into our own Rehoboth, into a place where you get to a point, yeah, you've tried business one, you've tried this one, you've tried that one, you've tried that one. He said, but I will take you into a place whereby I will give you something that is bringing you abundance. I'll give you into a place where you think you had room, but I will give you much more room. I'll give you what? Much more room. But let me say this to you. What made God to be committed to Abraham was, what God made God to be committed to Isaac was because Isaac became committed to Abraham. There is something about God. He has respect unto the ones who have respect unto covenant. Sometimes when you read the story and the news that is going on right now, if you were reading BBC, perhaps yesterday, today, you realize, or you're reading CNN, you realize, or you'll be scared. You say, but we pray, or we hope, or we thought that Hillary Clinton was leading Donald Trump by double digits just a few months ago. But they say, he's now leading her. But let me say something to you. God doesn't look at polls or statistics. Are you with me? If there is any reason or one of the reasons why that woman could win is in the fact that she found somebody that God loved. She found somebody that God favored. She found somebody that other people... You see, never has it happened in the history of America that people rejoice over somebody that was elected. And if there's anything she's doing, she went back. No matter how fearsome it has been on the campaign trail for her, she stuck with President Obama. No matter how bad Bill Clinton has gone through in his life, he still ended up as one of the best, like I said to us last week. Bill Clinton, in every survey, I just ordered some books, in every survey, he still always end up in the top six best American ever. So she understood something that, look, you might be throwing arsenal at this guy that he fell in infidelity. You might be throwing this one at this one. But one thing I know is that the whole populace love these people. When God is with you, the best place to be is with you. See, David was a man God has covenanted with. Even when he was a murderer, you still stay behind him. Because let me tell you something about God. God doesn't repent. You see, when God signs blessings with you, he won't come back and say, because of what you did, what have you. You see, this is why when Saul. When David confronted Saul, and the servant was saying, let's kill him, let's do it. He said, no. Once anointed, ever anointed. This man is God's anointed. I am not going to touch him. I'm not going to do, because God doesn't withdraw his anointing. He can recall the anointed. God does not withdraw anointing. He can recall the anointed. Please, somebody write that down for me and ping it back to me or send it to me as hashtag Abraham Gray. God does not what? Recall the, God does not, as I say just now, God does not withdraw the anointing. He only recalls the anointing as at when needed. That's why the Bible said the gift and the calling of God are without what? They are without repentance. So when you see a blessed man, remain with him. Some people will say, oh, despite all that man of God is going through, you see, I don't want to be associated with him. This is what people are saying. Look, if you were living in the day of Moses, or you were living in the day of David, there's somebody that something was going on around him or around his life, and I was telling Pastor Calde, tell Pastor Quint also, that I have a reason for choosing to still pray, to still associate, not because I believe or I don't believe anything that is being said or what have you, but because I recognize that God's hand is upon this person. Are you with me? Because you see, there's no matter how tough it is, that man will come out of whatever the situation is eventually. But God can bless you because you supported his own or you restored his own. That was what was happening to Isaac. Isaac was able to enact his own blessing based on two things. One, he obeyed also the voice of the Lord himself. God said, don't go. So when God said, don't go, he found what to do and he began to build his father's well. He began to plant in the same land at the same time. And he moved from there and dug another well and did not quarrel over it. For he called its name Rehoboth because he said, for now the Lord has made room for us. The Lord will make room for us. The Lord will make room for you. I said, the Lord will make room for you. The Lord will make room for me. And we shall be fruitful in the land. Somebody said, we shall be fruitful in the land. I want you to say it with conviction. We shall be fruitful in the land. Verse 23. Then he went up from there to Beth Shida. You will go up. I said, you will go up. I said, you will go up. And somebody say, I will go up.
I will go up.
Say, I am going up.
I am
up. That was his next level of encounter. Now, I want us to, let's finish it before we go home. Because God showed a sign through the rest of the verses by reenacting the covenant over again. So what God did was, with Isaac, God came to reopen the covenant. God came to reenact the covenant. It's like when you take a mortgage. The mortgage is signed for a longer years, but the variables are renewed like 2 years interval. The change exchange rate or inflation in the country or policy changes, they will go through remortgaging. Now let's read it on verse 24. He said, and the Lord appeared to him in the same night and said, I am the God of your father Abraham. Do not fear, for I am with you. I will bless you and multiply your descendant for my servant Abraham's sake. Because of your dad, I'm going to bless you. Verse 25. So he built an altar there and called the name of the Lord. And he pitched his tent there. And there Isaac's servant dug a well. Verse 26. Came to him from Gerar with Ahuzzath and of his friend and Pishon, the commander of the army. That is now the prime minister or the president of the country coming to visit him. With the major general rear admiral of the state of the nation. That is how important he has become now. And Isaac said unto them, why have you come to me, since you hate me and have sent me away from you? In other words, he has his own territory right now. When we are talking about God gave Abraham Canaan, he inherited the land, and then he passed the blessing. Can you now see that he's already been sent away from? Because a lot of the time when God said he will give you a land, many of us, because you don't have paper, you disbelieve God. Because you think that God saying he will give it to you is in a certain way he must do it. If somebody get what I'm saying? This is Abraham dead. He's still not the owner of the land. But in God's book, he's already giving it to him. At this time now, his son is even being chased. And for you to understand why the temperament of Isaac being an introvert can affect him a lot, his brother had already now started the Mediterranean Peninsula, the Arab world. We saw it in the previous chapter. Ishmael had already become a king and he had princes. He had several people. By the time he came for his father's burial, he was already in place. He was in charge. And here was Isaac, the one they call the heir to the promise. Here was him struggling with reptiles. But let's read it on. But he said, we have certainly seen. Watch this. We have certainly seen. I said people will see.
Amen.
I said people will see.
Amen.
Nations will see.
Amen.
Kingdom will certainly see. Amen. He said, but we have certainly seen that the Lord is with you. So we said, let there now be an oath between us, between you and us. And let us make a covenant with you. A man in covenant with God attracts covenant from others. The man said, look, we own this land, though. We are now going to strike a covenant. This is a land God had given his father. This is the promises God is giving his father. Now, when you now understand what God was saying in the book of Deuteronomy, he said, I've given you Sion, the Amorite, and his land. He said, now begin to possess it and begin. That means it's in process. God is taking you somewhere. God is taking you somewhere.
Amen.
I said, God is taking you somewhere.
Amen.
I said, God is taking me somewhere.
Amen.
God is taking us somewhere.
Amen.
So what God is saying he wants to do in your life, what God says he wants to do in our church, what God said he wants to do in our nation, he has a process for it. He has a timing for it. He has a commitment to it. And he's going to do it. That you will do us no harm, since you have not touched, we have not touched you. And since you have done nothing, we have done nothing to you but good, and have sent you away in peace. You are now the blessed of God. You are not blessed until other people say and call you blessed. You see, I know what I'm doing. That means you don't know what you are doing. You see, I'm very rich. That means you are not rich. When you are anything, you are not the one that call yourself that thing. The people that will tell you. You see, I am very kind. You are not. If you have to be titling yourself, you see, it's not people that give you a title. It is not you that title yourself. Who you are is what people describe you. Your true description is from others. Do you know that most people's autobiography is not written by them? Most great people's autobiography are told by people who felt the impact of their life. Are we together? Verse 30. So he made them a feast, and they ate and drank. Then they arose early in the morning and swore an oath with one another. And Isaac sent them away, and they departed from him in peace. And it came to pass that the same day that Isaac's servant came and told him about the well which they had dug, and he said unto him, we have found. All of a sudden, they are finished writing the oath. that, look, we will do you no harm. All after the oath has been done, they say, you are now a citizen. We own this land together. You have 60%. We have 40. All the contract has been dotted. All of a sudden, they came to tell him that we just found gold. If it was before they had come, you see, God can move the earth, move the people of the earth. He can move anything. He knows how to be able to rearrange your destiny and make everything work together for our good. All you need is alignment with God. All you need is what? Alignment with God. Verse 33, the last verse, everybody. We go up to 35. He said, so he called it Sheba. Therefore, the name of the city is Sheba, bear Sheba to this day. Then Esau was 40 years old, and he took wives, Judith, the daughter of Beri, the Hittite, and Basemath, the daughter of Elo. We will deal with that one next. Let's rise up. Let's rise up. Unto the Lord be the glory. Great things he has done. Unto the Lord. Great things. Now let's read that verse 35 together, because it's the only verse remaining there. Let me just quickly just cover it. I'll paraphrase. He said, and they were a grief of mine to Isaac and Rebekah. May your children not take steps that will become a grief of mind to you in the name of Jesus. Now, when you say grief of mind, is different from anger. There are people that are angry at the step their children is taking, not necessarily because it's wrong, but because they don't want that. Somebody might say, I don't want my children to marry from Nigeria. I don't want my child to marry from Kosovo. For a particular reason. But what was the grief of Isaac and Rebecca? Because God had a covenant with Abraham. And Abraham enacted that covenant by sending Eliezer. So they look at their own marriage that is a product of obedience of their father to the instruction of God not to marry of the people of the land. That is why the father sent for Rebecca in a strange land. And that is how they want to raise their own children too. But not only did Esau marry the one, he married two. But why was it? Is that he had been trained not to be obedient to his father. He was obedient to his father, but his father had listened. So no matter what he does, because the father is introvert, he's just a very peaceful man. But the mother, who could lead him aright, he was not going to listen to. Because the way the parents were raising them, the father loved one and the mother loved the other. But by divine arrangement, because he took that step that he took, he ended up with the wrong wife or wives. The steps he began to take in his life begin to deteriorate. So him losing the blessing is not just a function of the food or the fact that Rebecca said, go and bring this. He had already started taking steps by himself that is contrary to the covenant of the family. Are you with me? By the marriage of two of the Hittites, he had already violated the instruction of God in that family. Please, parents, we must understand this. Your children must understand what is right and what is wrong. What God has covenanted with me, it is my responsibility to pass it to my children. But this is what the Lord says. We must live a prayerful life. We must continually read the word of God. We must, everything that is God's covenant with you. See, Pastor, they are children, they are still children. He doesn't understand what tithing means. You teach them from day one, from the day they are born, from the money that people give on their behalf. You make it become their lifestyle. You make them understand what it is to memorize the scripture. You make them understand what it is to... He said, children don't want to have prayer or to do devotion. They are busy playing. But you make them understand what is the covenant of God for this family. Because it's the covenant that has made us who we are. And it's the covenant that will enact God's blessing upon them. Jacob, on the other hand, being restrained by his mother. The circumstances and the experiences of his life sent him. He ended up marrying from the right place. He ended up inheriting. The experience of him running from his brother led to his encounter. I pray today that the Lord, God Almighty, will strike a fresh covenant with you and I in the precious name of Jesus. Every great covenant that God has struck with us in this church, I invoke them over the life of everyone listening to me here today in the precious name of Jesus. Remember, God does not withdraw his anointing. God does not charter his covenant. Rather, he can only withdraw the anointing. May God not withdraw any of us. Instead, like he did with Isaac, may God come back and top up our covenant with him. May God come back and re-engage his covenant with us in the name of Jesus. May God's countenance be happy with us continually in the name of Jesus. So as we partake of this communion table today, this is the covenant of Jesus. And when he was going, he said this, he said, as long as you do this in the remembrance of me. Now, Christ is the seed of Abraham.